Good evening to one and all present over here. Welcome back to second day of World Education Summit. I, Dr. S. Nagarajan, Principal of Surendra Institute of Engineering and Management, Siliguri, West Bengal, and Deputy Director of CWSIR, invite you all to join for the prayer cup virtual lighting of lamp to formally inaugurate the second day of World's Greatest Virtual Summit on Education.
Sir, there's no sound.
Thank you so much for joining for second day of virtual summit. Before moving on to the today's agenda, let me brief about our organization to the panelists. Charles Walter Society for Innovation and Research, founded by Dr. Smita Tiwari in 2019 and under the able presidency of Dr. Abhishek Pandey. Vision for promoting research and innovation and targets the mission to strengthen the society with enlightened intellect and wisdom through the specific ideology from the specialized field. CWSIR is a staunch believer that research, creativity, and innovation can only guide the entire fraternity of education to a destiny that can produce good literature, research scholars, national, international patents, a wider perspective to develop and implement feasible definition of living in the current scenario. Believing in team and collaborative work, Charles Walter Society for Innovation and Research pays heartfelt gratitude to its executive members, state and country coordinators, country ambassadors, board of directors, and CWSIR Secretariat and all other governing bodies members. And about the summit, the World Education Summit is the premier international platform dedicated to innovation and creative actions in the education sector. Here, top decision makers share insight with on-ground practitioners and collaborate to rethink and find out various emerging opportunities in the education landscape at present and in future. This summit aims to explore groundbreaking innovations and encourage steps to ensure significant improvements in the global education sector. No doubt, education has been one of the most impactful sectors worldwide. World Education Summit would provide everyone with the opportunities to network, share experience, and expand knowledge in the past developing academic sphere. The day one yesterday, we had a detailed deliberation on grassroots approach on new educational system from infrastructure to building a strong foundation. Around 21 speakers from in and around various countries were participated and presented their views in this context. And today, the second day, we are going to discuss about the journey towards a new world, the new way of learning with offline, online, and with blended learning. The concluding day of the event, especially today, we would future about the future of education in India and the role of digital system. Especially, we are going to discuss about the past, present, and future of the education. And with this, I now invite Dr. Kushum Kanwar, Executive Director, NITEX CWSIR, to give an intro talk about our organization. Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you so much. Greetings and namaste to all luminaries and participants. Thank you, CWSIR, Charles Walter Society for Innovation and Research. Dr. Abhishek Pandey, sir, for the honor. and in gratitude to Mr. Nagarajan for giving me this platform. The vision of CWSIR is to empower, enable, and inspire the trend of research and innovation to learners with the right foundation of values and culture through academic excellence for global perspective, and to create an ecosystem for the holistic development of all stakeholders. Our mission is to provide an environment for research and innovation, encourage the research bent of learning that creates multivalent competencies in growing learners to enable them to become analytical leaders. Our commitments, and CWSIR is committed to uplift the society by providing voice and platform to women who are in the field of research and social work, thus strengthening them nationally and globally. Empowering schools to eliminate the rural and urban divide. Enhancing quality learning through sessions, igniting the spirit of innovation and research. To work towards achieving the United Nations SDGs, the Sustainable Developmental Goals, to create a harmonious society. International collaborations to work on common projects to give maximum learning exposure to budding innovators. Our services, the society strives to empower and support every learner in the domain of innovation and research by providing a platform for the following: guidance to write theses and research proposal writing, guidance by experts to get original research papers published, assistance to get international patents, placement for the researchers and for those who are involved in research innovation, and academia. Provision of platform to demonstrate innovative practices in education, commerce, arts, science, and technology, and others. Recommending the eligible members for the United Nations talks and for conducting master training in schools, colleges, and universities around the globe. Curating the international conferences, summits, and quality sessions under our initiative. Our initiative at MEJEX, it organizes national and international conferences, seminars, symposiums, and quality workshops. Academic curriculum assistance and content writing. MEJEX is recognizing and honoring the general contribution of individuals in diverse streams and disciplines with certified and authorized awards and honoris causa doctorate on the basis of the exceptional work. There are innumerable strategies and projects to empower women, developing numerous workshops and trainings. Now to wrap up, and last but not the least, personality grooming sessions and mentoring and coaching. Thank you and namaste, and over to you, Mr. Nagaraj.
Thank you, ma'am. Let's move on to introducing our special guest and guest of honors of today's show. This is an immense pleasure to announce the world's best brains as the chief guest, guest of honor, and keynote speakers in the second day of World Education Summit organized by Charles Waldo Society for Innovation and Research. We feel so blessed to listen to the talk of history creators in the context of education in this grand global summit. It is really great to be witnessing the enlightenment bringing wisdom and an iconic talent together. I would like to thank our Honorable Education Minister, Dr. Sri Dharmendra Pradhan, for accepting our invitation to be the chief guest of this World Education Summit. Sir will be joining little late. I also thank Mr. Anurag Thakur, Minister of State Finance and Corporate Affairs, Government of India, Sri Arjun Ram Negwal, Minister of State for Parliamentary Affairs, for their constant support and encouragement to make this virtual summit possible. With that small introduction, let us welcome and introduce the guest of honors of today's summit, Dr. Abdullah Rashid, Minister of State Education, Maldives. Sir is the Minister of State for Education, Republic of Maldives. He is a distinguished educationist with 30 years of experience in the field of education. Dr. Rashid served as a principal of government school for 18 years. He is a former vice rector of AVIT College and is currently head of the National Institute of Education. Dr. Rashid was awarded with title of the best principal of Maldives in 2010. He is also the Global Goodwill Ambassador of International Education Advisory Council. He holds his PhD in Institutional Leadership from ACIE University, Malaysia, and in Educational Leadership from University of Nottingham, United Kingdom. Shah will be the right person to comment about today's agenda. I request Shah to share his thoughts on today's topic with his experience. Sir, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Assalamu alaikum and very good evening to all the distinguished excellencies, participants, and everyone. It gives me a great pleasure to share my thoughts and experience regarding today's discussion, Journey Towards the New World of Education. I can say this is extremely a very important topic for 21st century. We are living in 21st century. Things are changing. Industrial Revolution 4.0, 5.0, 21st century skills, knowledge-based economy, globalization. For because of all these reasons, we are living in a new world. Therefore, the journey of education also focused in such a manner. Years back, teaching was very much teacher-centered, very much content-oriented, very much exam-oriented, believing that education is just memorizing, education is just transferring the knowledge. But now we all know education is more than that, broader than that, and the purpose is to prepare our students for 21st century. Therefore, the teaching learning for the new world should be transformed. It should be more project-based. It should be more problem-based. Should give emphasis on developing students' creativity. Knowledge is now everywhere. Previously, only the lecturers or the teachers are only the source of knowledge. But now it is no more, because knowledge is everywhere. Knowledge is everyone's fingertip. Therefore, why should we just pour the knowledge? Rather than doing that, we have to make it more practical. We should give more emphasis on developing students' 21st century skills. As I said before, out of these 21st century skills, the most important or the highest priority, in my belief, should be developing students' creativity. Because we know that the richest people in the world, richest companies in the world, they are not using any natural resource. They are not using wood, land, gold, silver, wood. They are using the intellectual capital. They are using the creativity. Some names, if you name some the richest people, the top in the list, everyone, their business is led by, driven by creativity and innovation. Jeff Bezos, founder and the president of Amazon, innovation, creativity, Microsoft, Bill Gates, Elon Musk, Mark Zuckerberg, Larry Page, Tim Cook, and the list goes on. So all these people are rich because of their creativity and innovation. Even some research show that in less developed countries, the kind of work we do are routine work either done by machine or routine work done by the people. But in developed countries, it is creative and innovative work, more research, dissemination of knowledge, creation of knowledge. Therefore, rather than taking much time, let me tell you, in new world, we have to transform the way we teach, the way we educate. Even we should redefine education. I don't really believe that just giving a test paper to the students and students just write the knowledge and then we say, this is the brightest child, that is the best child. I don't think, because in the real life, it's not how students work or people work, people create or be productive. Therefore, with this note, I like to conclude by thanking everyone for listening to me, organizers for inviting me. It is really great, good to create knowledge and do the research, disseminate the research. That's the most important thing. I wish this conference would be a very successful conference for you all. Thanks, and a wonderful night for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful speech. Especially, you have nicely highlighted about Industry 4.0 and 5.0 and how education sector can support for the fast growing industry revolution. Thank you so much for your wonderful speech on second day of virtual summit. Now I humbly request and invite Dr. Jagadish Gandhi, legendary education at India, and Dr. Gandhi, a visionary icon of value-based education in mighty India for more than 50 years, and a visionary and a far-sighted person. Dr. Jagadish Gandhi has been building bridges of peace across the globe for nearly 50 years. For his long-standing contributions to education in peace, the United Nations awarded the prestigious UNESCO Prize for Peace Education in the year 2002 to his unique creation, the City Montessori School, popularly known as CMS, which Gandhi founded in 1959 and has been serving as its founder manager with this small introduction. Now I invite Dr. Jagadish Gandhi, legendary educationist, to give an inaugural speech on this grand virtual summit. Sir, over to you.
Yeah, Mr. Akhilesh, Abhishek Pandeji, Mr. Naga Rajanji, and just now I heard Dharmendra Pradhanji is about to come, and I heard Dr. Abdullah Rashid, Minister of State for Education of Maldives. It's a wonderful speech he has given. Dear friends, that today's education has given man four ills: godlessness, ignorance, confusion, and conflict. The purpose of today's education must be the redemption of mankind from its godlessness, its ignorance, its confusion, and its conflict. What is the school? A school must be restored to its traditional role as the transmitter of morality, builders of character, and custodians of the culture. Dear friends, education is a continuous and a creative process. Its aim is to develop the capacities latent in human nature and to coordinate their expression for the enrichment and progress of society by equipping children with material, human, and divine knowledge. Through education, religious capacity develops analytical ability, confidence in oneself, willpower, and goal-setting competencies, and instills the vision that will enable him to become a self-motivated agent of social transformation. Dear friends, man has three realities of life. Man is a material being, man is a human being, man is a divine being. He needs a balanced education of all the three realities of life. Victor Hugo said, there is one thing stronger than all the armies in the world, and that is an idea whose time has come. What is that time has come? You know, the balanced education of all the three realities of life is the, you know, is an idea whose time has come. So our schools are giving material education too much, but at the same time, human education and divine education should equally is important, and all the three realities of life must be catered simultaneously. You know that a child has three classrooms. First, the mother's lap, the home of the child. Second is the formal school. And third is the society. These are the three classrooms of a child. And man has three characters: his innate character, his inherited character, and its acquired character. But as far as the question of innate character is concerned, innate is God-given, is born with the character, a child is born with this kind of character, so we can't do anything. Inherited character also comes from the genes of the parents and grandparents. So we also can't do anything. And the third thing is the acquired character, which the child acquires from home, from his school, and from the society. These are his three classrooms where from the child learns the lessons of life. As far as the question of our home is concerned, today's home, the parents have no time to educate the children, give them a balanced education of all the three realities of life. They have no time to give human education and divine education. The only thing they ask is to the child, how many marks you have got. That is all. Beyond that, they are not prepared to teach him human education and divine education, whereas these are the realities of a child. Man is a material being. Man is a human being. Man is a divine. Dear friends, the basic purpose of all the religion is to safeguard the interest and promote the unity of the human race and to foster the spirit of love and fellowship amongst men. That is the basic purpose. The basic purpose of education is the redemption of mankind from its godlessness. These are the four ills. That should be the first purpose of education, that is redemption of mankind from its godlessness, its ignorance, its confusion, and its conflict. The children should be prepared with this idea that one day I will unite the world. Ek din duniya, ek karunga, dharti, swarg, banaunga, aur vishw, shanti ka, sapna ek din, sach karke, dikhlaunga. This is the 21st century education. Dr. Abdullah Rashid gave importance to this aspect. He said that we need to give 21st century education. And this is the education for the 21st century. Prepare the mindset of our children to be global. So we have to prepare our children's mind as a global citizen. Education for the 21st century must be different from that of the 20th century. In the 21st century, a child should be given the education of how to make a world parliament. You know, in our school, children are exposed to the world parliament. Every class, they have to perform a world parliament in every function. So we are creating the mindset that ultimately in your life, you have to make the ultimately goal should be to create a world parliament. Not the United Nations, kind of United Nations, where there are five veto powers, America, China, Russia, France, and England. We don't want these veto powers. We want a world parliament as envisaged in Article 51 of the Constitution of India. Article 51 of the Constitution of India says the state shall endeavor A, to promote international peace and security, B, maintain just and honorable relations between nations, C, foster respect for international law, and D, encourage settlement of international disputes by arbitration. The question is, who will do the arbitration? United Nations is beset with five veto powers, and that is, it is divided into five power blocks. So they cannot decide the issues between the nations. For example, the issue of India and Pakistan. They have not been able to solve the problem of India and Pakistan, Israel or Palestine, South Korea or North Korea. You know, there are many problems all around the world. And there have been so many territorial wars between India and Pakistan. There have been 3 wars. So it's everywhere. But the question is Israel and Palestine. Every day there is a war. The question is, United Nations is an organization of nations who are the members. They donate money. It is an institution being run by donations. But what kind of world parliament is the need of the hour? Recently, the whole world has faced corona. And this corona is such a deadliest disease which beset, which can be tackled only by unity of the entire mankind. Our Prime Minister has several times said that now the time has come for the unification of the world. So the whole world should be united, and children should be prepared right from the childhood to think in terms of forming a world parliament. I send my children every year to, for the past 2 years, I'm not sending because of corona. But previously, I was sending my children to America every time for visiting the Kennedy Space Research Center. But there was one thing compulsory for them, to go to the United Nations and visit the General Assembly Hall so that they realize that one day they have to create a world parliament of this kind where the whole world can come here. So this kind of mindset we are preparing for the 21st century. So we are preparing. A child is holding the globe on his head. This shows that we have to think in terms of globe. The earth is but one country and mankind is citizen. Ye pura prithvi ek desh hai aur manushya matra iske nagrik hai. Ye dharti hamari maa hai aur parmatma hamara pita hai. Aur parmatma ki jitni bhi ye santane, sari duniya ke santan, ye sab ek parmatma ki santan. Sare messengers of God, those who have brought the messages of God, they have all come from one God. Their message has come from one God. So this kind of education, is time has come. The 21st century education must be given to our children that God is one, religion is one, man is one. So this kind of education is the need of 21st century. The children should realize there is only one God. God of Krishna, God of Muhammad, God of Nanak, God of Jesus, God of Baha'u'llah, Bab, and God of Moses, Abraham, all the God is only one. They are all messengers of God. They have brought the messages from time to time, from age to age. That's our Bhagavad Gita says, Yada Yada Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Bharate Abhyuttanam Dharmasya Tadatmanam Sujamya Paritranaya Sadhunam Vinashaya Chadushkatam Dharma Sastapanataya Sambhavami Yuge Yuge. To institutionalize the religion, Dharma Sthapanartha Nahi, Dharma Sastapanataya Sastapana Bane Sastaki Sthapana Karna Nai Nai Niyamavali Dena समाज के लिए. जब 7,500 वर्ष भगवान श्री राम इस धरती पर आए तो मर्यादा पुरुषोत्तम भगवान श्री राम कहलाए, क्योंकि उन्होंने मानव जीवन को मर्यादित किया. और ये जो मर्यादा की शिक्षा है, ये मानव जाति के लिए है. ये हिंदू मुस्लिम सिख ईसाई ये है. उस समय तो कोई जातियां भी नहीं थी. जब राम का जन्म हुआ 7,500 वर्ष, कोई भी जाति नहीं थी, केवल मानव जाति. 5,000 वर्ष पूर्व भगवान कृष्ण का आगमन होता है और उन्होंने कहा, यदा यदा धर्मस्य ग्लानिर्भवति भारते अभ्युत्थान मधर्मस्य तदात्मानं सृजाम्यहं परित्राणाय साधूनां. साधु प्रवृत्ति के जो लोग हैं उनका परित्राण करने के लिए, एंड विनाशाय जो दुष्टताम दुष्कर्म करने वालों का विनाश करने के लिए, विनाशाय जो दुष्टताम धर्म संस्थापनार्थ ये टू इंस्टीट्यूशनलाइज द रिलीजन टू गिव द न्यू सोशल लॉ रिक्वायर्ड फॉर द डे आई विल कम अगेन एंड अगेन. तो प्रति बार बार हर युग में एक अवतार आते हैं और नया नया संदेश देते हैं. 7,500 वर्ष राम आए, 5,000 वर्ष उसी परमात्मा की ओर से कृष्ण संदेश लाए, 2,500 वर्ष उसी परमात्मा की ओर से भगवान बुद्ध संदेश लाए जिसमें था सम्यक ज्ञान. सब बराबर है, ये ऊंच नीच गलत है. ब्राह्मण बड़े ऊंचे, क्षत्रिय उससे नीचे, वैश्य उसके भी नीचे, शूद्र उसके भी नीचे. ये व्यवस्था तो मनुष्यों की बनाई है, परमात्मा ने ऊंचा नीचा किसी को नहीं बनाया. तो बुद्ध ने कहा, सम्यक ज्ञान दिया और उनके चले जाने के बाद करीब आज से 2,000 वर्ष प्रभु यीशु मसीह आए. उन्होंने कहा, लव थाई नेबर, अपने पड़ोसी को प्रेम करो, और सारा संसार परमात्मा का पड़ोसी है. तो सारी सृष्टि से अपना मानो कि सब हमारे पड़ोसी हैं, सबसे प्यार करो. यही बात उन्होंने कही कि करुणा और दया जिसमें होगी उस पृथ्वी का राजा बनेगा, इस पृथ्वी का सम्राट वो होगा जिसके जीवन में करुणा और दया हो. और 1400 वर्ष पूर्व हजरत मोहम्मद आए. उन्होंने कहा, पहली आयत जो कुरान शरीफ की है उसमें है खुदा रब्बुल आलमीन है, रब्बुल मुसलमीन नहीं, वो मुसलमानों का नहीं, वो आलमीन का रब है, इस धरती का रब है, सृष्टि का रब है, सारी सृष्टि को बनाने वाला एक अल्लाह है, एक खुदा है, उसके नाम अनेक है. उसे जर्मन लैंग्वेज में क्या कहते हैं, फ्रेंच में क्या कहते हैं, रशियन में क्या कहते हैं, इस हर भाषा में उसका एक नाम है, उसके नाम तो हजारों. उसे इंडिया में भी भगवान भी कहते हैं, ईश्वर भी कहते हैं, अल्लाह भी कहते हैं, खुदा भी कहते हैं, वाहेगुरु भी कहते हैं, उसके नाम अनेक है लेकिन वो एक है. तो ये बातें बच्चों को बताना आज के युग में बहुत जरूरी है, क्योंकि आज जातियों के नाम पर झगड़े हैं, धर्मों के नाम पर दूरियां बढ़ रही हैं, झगड़े बढ़ते चले जा रहे हैं. तो ये सब बच्चों को आज की शिक्षा इस 21वीं सदी में ये शिक्षा देना बहुत जरूरी है. तो बच्चों को ये शुरू से ज्ञान कराए कि एक ही छत के नीचे हो. अब सब धर्मों की प्रार्थना परम पिता है, एक सभी का सब में हो ये भावना. तो एक पिता है, अब सब में हो ये भावना, और सभी धर्मों की प्रार्थना एक ही छत के नीचे हो. हमारे स्कूल में एक ही छत के नीचे सब धर्मों की प्रार्थना होती है, सर्व धर्म प्रार्थना, जिसके लिए महात्मा गांधी जी मॉर्निंग और इवनिंग सर्व धर्म प्रार्थना करते थे. उनकी शिक्षा यही है. महात्मा गांधी जी ने कहा था, इफ वी वांट टू टीच द रियल पीस इन दिस वर्ल्ड, इफ वी वांट टू कैरी ऑन ए रियल वार अगेंस्ट वार, वी शैल हैव टू बिगिन विद द चिल्ड्रन. यदि हमें युद्ध के विरुद्ध युद्ध करना है और यदि हमें शांति लानी है दुनिया में, तो उसका एक ही तरीका है, और बच्चों की एजुकेशन. विक्टर ह्यूगो ने, नेल्सन मंडेला ने कहा था, एजुकेशन इज द मोस्ट पावरफुल वेपन विच यू कैन यूज टू चेंज द वर्ल्ड. तो यहाँ पर जो एजुकेशनिस्ट बड़े बड़े बैठे हैं, मेरा उनसे यही कहना है कि ये तो आपके हाथ में एक ऐसी चीज है, बच्चों की शिक्षा, कि यू कैन चेंज द वर्ल्ड. तो ये सारी दुनिया बदल सकते हैं आप. तो ये बदलने का समय आ गया है, और मैं समझता हूँ कि मेरा टाइम पूरा हो गया है, तो मैं अपनी बात को समाप्त कर दूं, या मुझे टाइम और है क्या, बताएं. मैं 5 मिनट और ले सकता हूँ.
यस सर, यस सर.
ऑलराइट, थैंक यू. तो मैं आपसे कह रहा था, पुतली बाई के जब बेटा हुआ, एक सहेली आई, उससे पुतली बाई ने पूछा कि मेरे बेटा हुआ है, मैं इसे बहुत महान बनाना चाहती हूँ, तो कैसे बना सकती हूँ. तो सहेली ने कहा, ये तो बहुत आसान है, अरे किसी महान से दोस्ती करा देना, महानता के गुण आ जाएंगे, तो तेरा बेटा महान बन जाएगा. तो पुतली बाई बोली कि ये महान कहां से तलाश करूंगी मैं? और कोई महान मिल भी गया तो मेरे गांव में क्यों आएगा? तो सहेली ने कहा कि देख, ये तू संसार का सबसे महान पुरुष बनाना चाहे तो बहुत आसान है। बोले वो कैसे? अरे सबसे महान तो परमात्मा है, वो तो हमारे घट घट में है, उसकी तू दोस्ती करा देना। तो परमात्मा से दोस्ती कैसे कराऊंगी? अरे उसको परमात्मा के भजन सिखा देना, उसको कीर्तन सिखाना, उसे अच्छी अच्छी ईश्वर की बातें बताना। और तो उसकी माँ की बात समझ में आई, उसने एक चद्दर बिछाई, अपने बच्चे को उसमें रखा, पोटली बनाई और धीरे धीरे मंदिर में पहुंच गई। मंदिर में जाके पोटली खोल दी और बच्चे को रख दिया भगवान के सामने और गुनगुनाने लगी, इसे अपनी शरण में ले लो नाथ, इसे अपनी शरण में ले लो रे नाथ, अपनी शरण में ले लो नाथ, इसे अपनी शरण में ले लो रे नाथ। रोजाना भजन करती और पोटली बनाती, कंधे पर डालती, ले आती। धीरे धीरे करके गांधी जी बड़े होने लगे और एक दिन मंदिर में ही आंख भी खोल दी और कानों से सुनने भी लगे। और माँ का जब सौम्य स्वरूप देखा भजन करते हुए तो माँ पर वो मोहित हो गए और माँ से भजन सीखने लगे। और फिर तो यहाँ तक हो गए कि माँ जल्दी चलो मंदिर में, सत्संग छूट जाएगा, हमारे अच्छे अच्छे भजन सुनने से हम वंचित रह जाएंगे। तो माँ से जल्दी जल्दी चलने के लिए कहने लगे थे। एक दिन एक टीचर उनके घर आए और उन्होंने मोहनदास के गांधी जी के पिताजी मोहनदास करमचंद गांधी से कहा कि आपका बेटा बड़ा ढीठ हो गया है। हैं गुरु जी, मेरा बेटा आपकी आज्ञा का क्या पालन नहीं करता, जिया नहीं करता है? तो उन्होंने कहा बताइए क्या बात हुई। तो उनके कल हमारे यहाँ इंस्पेक्टर आए थे, उन्होंने एक कैटिल शब्द दिया कि सब बच्चे स्पेलिंग लिखे, सब बच्चों को आते थे, सबने लिखे, इनको आते नहीं थे। तो जब इंस्पेक्टर आगे निकल गए तो मैंने अपने बूट से इशारा किया कि तुम आगे के बच्चे से नकल कर लो, तो मेरा मंतव्य तो समझ गए, लेकिन इन्होंने नकल नहीं की और ये फेल हो गए और मेरे स्कूल का रिजल्ट भी खराब हो गया। तो गांधी जी के पिताजी बोले कि मेरा बेटा क्या सचमुच इतना महान है कि आपके कहने पर भी उसने नकल नहीं की? जी हाँ, नहीं की। तो उन्होंने कहा कि गुरुजी, मैं अपने बेटे पर गर्व करता हूँ कि आपकी बात नहीं मानी, परमात्मा की बात उसने मानी। तो बच्चों को परमात्मा का ज्ञान कराना, परमात्मा की आज्ञाओं को पूरा कराना बच्चों को सिखाना चाहिए। विक्टर बहुत सारे लोगों ने कहा है कि बच्चों को शुरू से ही पालने में ही अच्छे अच्छे गुण माताएं पिता भर देते हैं। माता पिता दोनों ने महात्मा गांधी के जीवन में अच्छे अच्छे गुण भरे। जब वो लंदन जाने लगे तो माँ ने सीख दी, बहुत सारी सीख दी कि तुम बीड़ी सिगरेट नहीं पीना, तुम किसी स्त्री के साथ बुरी भावना से मत देखना, और जो जो चीजें बताई गांधी जी ने उनका पालन किया और गांधी जी धीरे धीरे करके इतने महान बने। तो मेरा कहना मतलब यही है कि बच्चों को, माता पिताओं को भी एजुकेट करने की जरूरत है। आज के स्कूल का काम केवल क्लासरूम में बच्चों को अंग्रेजी भूगोल गणित पढ़ाना भर नहीं है, मेटेरियल एजुकेशन देना जरूरी है, इसलिए सर्वश्रेष्ठ मेटेरियल एजुकेशन दीजिए, लेकिन ह्यूमन एजुकेशन और डिवाइन एजुकेशन दीजिए। और इसमें भागीदारी पेरेंट्स की देने के लिए पेरेंट्स को बुलाइए भारी तादाद में, जिसमें कि उनके बच्चों के कार्यक्रम कीजिए, ताकि अब तो कोरोना खत्म हो गया है, अब तो कार्यक्रम हो सकते हैं, तो इसलिए बच्चों के माता पिता आए और उनके सामने ऐसे कार्यक्रम बच्चों से कराइए जिससे कि उनकी आध्यात्मिकता का विकास हो और उनके करेक्टर का डेवलपमेंट हो और चरित्र का निर्माण हो। तो माता पिता को ये भी प्रिंसिपल को सीख देनी चाहिए कि अपने घर में वो शांति बनाए रखें, अपने घर में यूनिटी लाएं, क्योंकि आज के युगावतार बाहुल्ला ने कहा है, माय फर्स्ट काउंसिल इज दिस, बट इज ए प्योर काइंडली एंड ए रेडियंट आर्ट, द दान में भी है सोवरेनिटी एंशियंट इम्पेरिशेबल एंड एवरलास्टिंग। तो हमारा हे प्राणी तो एक पवित्र दयालु और ईश्वरीय प्रकाश से प्रकाशित हृदय धारण कर, तो ये भावना बच्चों में पैदा करनी चाहिए। और इसी के लिए तमाम लोगों ने कहा है कि तमाम महापुरुषों ने यही सब बातें बताई हैं, तो बच्चों के मन में ये डालिए कि वन डे आई विल यूनाइट द वर्ल्ड, एक दिन दुनिया एक करूंगा, धरती स्वर्ग बनाऊंगा, विश्व शांत का सपना एक दिन सच करके दिखलाऊंगा। थैंक यू वेरी मच, गॉड ब्लेस यू।
Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful inaugural speech on education. Especially, you have nicely highlighted about various perspective of education and the importance of human values to this wonderful platform. And once again, I convey my sincere gratitude on behalf of CWSER. Thank you so much, sir. Next, I call upon the another great educationist, Dr. Manpreet Singh Manna, former director AICT, associate professor at SLIEP, a centrally funded deemed university established by Government of India. I request Dr. Manpreet Singh Manna to share his experience on education. Sir, over to you.
Thank you very much. First of all, I am grateful to the whole organization to giving this opportunity to see such a gala event and to listening such a great visionaries. I was listening to Abdul Rashid ji and of course very honorable Gandhi ji. Whatever he spoken, a single word is touching the heart of every human being. Those are really doing something in education field, and I believe every human being is a teacher and every human being is a student first. And the teacher are the great learner of this world. We are the true learners. We are the effective learners. Then only we can participate something. So in this education summit, and it's a world's education summit, if we will speak of the one area, one region, I think we'll not do the justice. And I know that the agenda for this summit is to be understand, to recommend, to come forward, to make some sort of recommendations, how to create a global citizen, how to create a global citizen. And if I'll take forward the journey of this discussion from our very honorable speaker who just spoken before me about the three schools, starting from the mother's lap and going till this, you know, divine energy, divine education, it's really a matter of concern. I just share, from my childhood, I was hearing about IQ, EQ, SQ, and PQ. The quotients are amazing. And we have delivered so many talks, you know, on the different platforms by keeping these quotients, and we do present it very well. Yes, of course, if your emotion quotient is already there along with your physical quotient, of course, spiritual quotient, so then EQ can be get balanced. But one day during the COVID, when I was sharing with my students and they were got depressed, you know, were sitting at home, sir, we are not able to come to the classroom. We are not able to get a physical interaction with you all people and the libraries and our peers. We are getting depressed whether jobs will be there or nothing. Then I realized and immediately applied for the copyright. What was that? I applied for the naughtiness quotient, nat khatta pan, childhood. So, and I got a very, very different responses from my students. Sir, ye aapne kaise socha? Kyun socha? Yes. What is that? I feel, I believe, I may put my words. It is my word. It's my personal opinion. You may agree, may not agree. Jab tak insaan ke andar uska bachcha jeevit hai, wo insaan kuch bhi kar sakta hai. Kuch bhi kar sakta hai. जब आपके अंदर का चाइल्डहुड खत्म हो जाता है, यू नो व्हाई दिस थिंग केम इन माइंड, व्हेन आई वाज प्लानिंग फॉर द स्वयं फुल फॉर्म, बिकॉज़ द मंत्रालय गिवन अ वर्ड स्वयं टू बी गेट अ वर्ल्ड्स लार्जेस्ट मूक्स प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर व्हिच आई कुड सपोर्ट AICT MHRD बीइंग अ फॉर्मर डायरेक्टर ऑफ स्वयं, सो आई वाज एक्सप्लेनिंग द वर्ड SWAYM, स्टडी वेब्स ऑफ एक्टिव लर्निंग फॉर यंग एस्पायरिंग माइंड्स। देन आई रियलाइज्ड यंग एस्पायरिंग माइंड्स मींस हमारे देश में दो शब्द यूज होते हैं. अगर उस शब्द को हम दूसरे पर्यायवाची में यूज करते हैं, इफ यू स्पीक समथिंग बूढ़ा, वी फील इट एज अब्यूज्ड. बट व्हेन वी कॉल इट एज अ बुजुर्ग, इट इज अ वेरी रिस्पेक्टफुल वर्ड, बिकॉज वी जनरली से व्हेनेवर यू वांट्स टू डू समथिंग न्यू और मे बी समथिंग अ डिसीजन, वी मस्ट टेक एडवाइजेस फ्रॉम अवर द एल्डरली पेरेंट्स एट होम, दैट इज कॉल्ड बुजुर्ग. एंड बुजुर्ग आर द मोस्ट यंगेस्ट स्पेरिंग माइंड्स, बिकॉज एवरी डे they are learning from us, from one generation, then second generation, and of course the third generation, and they give a very exclusive remarks, comments, recommendations for any kind of executions. So who are the great mentors on this earth? Those are the senior citizens, elderly people, you know. And what is the missing, what when Gandhiji was talking here, I was realizing till my age, people, though have crossed 40, they got this opportunity to be sitting along with the grandpas and grandmas, dada, dadi and nana, nani, to understand what Gita says, what Ramayana says, what Sukhmani Path says, what the Quran Sharif says, because parents do not have the time. All the four hands are working. That's why they are fetching the luxurious life to the students, because nowadays the kids are asking for the AC. They are asking for the ITV. They are not asking only ki mele pe leke jao aur ek bas एक खिलौना दिला दो पूरा साल उसके साथ खेल लूंगा. अब नहीं है. द सेम डे दे आर आस्किंग फॉर द सेकंड टॉय एंड दे आर नॉट इवन आस्किंग, दे आर गोइंग टू द अमेज़न एंड दे आर बाइंग इट देमसेल्व्स, बिकॉज पापाज क्रेडिट कार्ड सीवीवी नंबर इज ऑलरेडी बाय हार्टेड बाय देम एंड द पेरेंट्स आर गिवन दिस लिवरेज, यू प्लीज जा सिमरन जी ले अपनी जिंदगी. इट्स समथिंग डिफरेंट, यू नो. सो द सेम टाइम वी आर गिविंग अ लग्जरीज टू देम, आर वी गिविंग द असेंशियल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ देयर लाइफ? एंड दैट कम्स फ्रॉम द ग्रैंड पेरेंट्स, दादा दादी की कहानी, नाना नानी के नुस्खे. एंड वाई दिस फैमिलीज, वी वर द ज्वाइंट फैमिलीज, वी वर द ज्वाइंट फैमिलीज, वी वर नॉट वी आर. टूडे इफ आई से इवन द हस्बैंड एंड वाइफ स्टेइंग टूगेदर, दे से वी आर द ज्वाइंट फैमिली मोस्ट ऑफ द सिटीज लाइक इन इंडिया, एंड दे आर स्टेइंग टूगेदर. वाई सो वी आर बिकमिंग सो न्यूक्लियर, सो न्यूक्लियर, सो न्यूक्लियर? सो दिस इज मीन वी हैव डिसिमिनेटेड द यूनिवर्सिटी. वट यूनिवर्सिटी? Our previous speaker, what he spoken, the first university, the first college, the first classroom is a mother's home. And mother's homes, the, you know what the chacha and chachi has to put the role, but dada and dadi has to put the role, but mossi and mossa has to put the role. This all faculty members are went away. And the two teachers available, that is a mother and father, they are very much busy for their career and for their fetching the food and fetching the shelter and other kind of demands of the kids. It does mean that our first pathshala got dismantled. Now I'll come to the second pathshala. That is my school education. From beginning from the school itself, the teachers keeps in mind their school result, their class result, their city result. They forget what is the development we required. They are looking every student sitting in the class should be either should be go for the medical or maybe for the engineering. They never think that I need a great politician also from my school. I need a great sportsman also from my school. I need a great magician. Forget it. I need a great human being from my school, from my class. They only worries about the 10 CGPA. Nothing else. 10 CGPA. All Tom, Dick and Harry is sitting in a class. They never distinguish who's the slow learner and fast learner. That's why the movie comes, Tare Zameen Par. So this movie was the eye-opening. We could not open our eyes to watch and to understand what Tare Zameen Par wants to be give the theme. The plot was very great. The theme was very heart-touching. But we just watched the movie. We just appreciate in the crowd and the gossips. And that's why we forget. All the teachers, including me. I'm also a faculty. The third part shala is the society. When they are coming from the school education to the higher education, like a technical education or maybe other professional education, the faculty is concerned about their own research first. Bhaiya, mujhe professor banna hai. You do this thesis. You do publish this paper, put my name as an author so that I can get a credits. Nobody is bothered what student is asking for you. They are asking only for the index, not happiness index. They are asking for the research index. Of course, but in my India, we should understand every college is not meant for research. And still we are failed to identify which universities are the research universities and which university are the teaching universities. And we are putting the same kind of guidelines for giving any kind of promotions or recruitments or everything, same guidelines. they have never distinguished, okay, these are the teaching universities, I will see the outcome. How many your passed out students are doing amazingly in this world? Maybe they are doing some NGOs, they are doing some volunteer services for the nation, or they are the great sportsman. And we are asking, no, how many books you have published, how many patents you have done, how many research papers you have published, then you become professor, HAG, vice chancellor, director, blah, 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 blah. Where is the end? Have we ever bothered how many generations passed out from you and how many come back to you to even giving you the marriage card, wedding card? Sir, aap meri shaadi pe nahi aayenge, toh main shaadi nahi karne wala hoon. That is a true education. Aapka judaav hua bachche ke saath. So I think my second and third paathshala also got dismantled somewhere. And finally, when all paathshalas are over and we are in the society to be served to the nation, because first come for the learn and goes to serve to the nation, or serve to the mankind, serve to the society, I think we are failed. Aap mujhe aadhi roti khilaoge to main pura nahi bhagne wala hu. I can't run because you fetch me half. You fetched partially to me. You have not given all ingredients, all vitamins to me. That's the point. So who's at the fault? Are the parents? Are the teachers? Or the policy makers? Or the regulators? Or the government? I think we all collectively should take this responsibility. Yes, we all has to understand it. We have to understand it. It starts from the parents. This journey goes till the regulators and the policy makers. When we are going to be. You see, such an amazing document came, NEP 2020, National Education Policy, is an amazing document. I don't find any page, any paragraph, any point which is not relevant to the essence of the education or a credibility of the student, but implementation can be a challenge. Without doing the mindset change, without creating that ecosystem in the faculty system, educational system, we can't implement such a beautiful document that is called a National Education Policy 2020 of India. It's a milestone. And it came after 35 years and it has to be remain for next 20 years. I'm sure in next 20 years, no next policy is going to become. We can't afford it for a four years sitting and doing the brainstorming with the multiple people and then finding out this kind of draft and finally it's going to get published. And we talk about the multiple entry exit. It's amazing. We talk about the language point formula. It's amazing. Everything. But have you ever checked what the teacher's pain, teacher's responsibility, and the teacher's due respect to be given in the society? Today in Chandigarh, if I'll ask for a driver for my car, I have to pay 18,000 rupees per month. But for a teacher in a school, I'm getting 6,000 rupees per month available with B.Ed., M.Ed. and with 5 years experience. Sir, please nokri de do. Sir, please nokri de do. 6,000 bhi chalega. What is that? And moreover, teachers should not have a salary. It's an honorarium because we can't buy a teacher. We can't buy a services. Education is not services. It's just your services towards the nation. It's a very cause. It's a very noble cause in the society to teach someone. And a professors like Gandhiji has spoken, I'm sure, in his school, they must not be charging that huge fee, but they are giving the great values. Because when he spoken, I was wondering, I must visit sometimes Lucknow to visit him personally. So I will definitely go and visit to Jagdish Gandhiji there. So this is what. We have to collaborate. In America, in some countries, what they have taken, you know, you are retired, sir. Yes, you are retired. 60 plus. Sir, are you free? Yes, I am free. So can you spend some time as a mentor to my school and college? They do happily come. Do we have this system? I think we are still silent. The great, great professors from IITs, from IIMs, they are sitting at home idly. They are reading newspapers. They are writing articles. They are watching TV. But they cannot come because you never open the doors to them. And what they expect from you, they have a sufficient amount. In India, the pension, the gratuity, the post-retirement benefits are too good because poot kaput to ta kyu sicha, poot saput to ta kyu sicha. So they don't have to put the money in their account. So they are sufficient. Only they need a respect. They need a respect. If we'll give a respect and the mentors will come to the schools and colleges, I think they will do the mentoring, not only the learners, even to the teachers. Those are the great learners of my country, of my society. That's my belief. So in this kind of platforms, we should speak away from, we should not be so diplomatic to speak. We should speak very true heart. and this is what our previous speakers have done, this is what I'm doing, we should understand what are our strengths. You know, the best skills, if anywhere, it is in India. It is in India. I can debate for a whole day if anybody speaks. Ancient value skills. Dronacharya said the first virtual classroom was the Dronacharya classroom. When Klavya have proven it with this virtual classroom system. It's not from today and tomorrow. We are doing this Zoom and Skype. It happened years and years and years back when that was. Because that was a feel. Ek shishya ko pata ki guru mere andar hai. Mera role model hai. Aaj role model, aapke Bollywood star role model ho jate hai. Teacher nahi role model ho pa raha. Kisi ke ghar mein professor ki tasveer mujhe bata dijiye kisne lagayi ho ke apne ghar mein. Lekin uske ghar mein celebrity ki tasveer ho sakti hai. कोई भी अच्छा बॉलीवुड सेलिब्रिटी आई डू लव सेलिब्रिटीज आई हैव नो प्रॉब्लम बट डू वी हैव द सेम काइंड ऑफ अ रिस्पेक्ट जिसने मुझे बनाया इस दुनिया में आपके सामने बोले लायक बनाया उसकी तस्वीर तो मैंने लगाई नहीं अपने घर में हु गिवन मी दिस लेवल ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन स्किल्स एंड दिस लेवल ऑफ कंटेंट टू बी स्पोकन बिफोर दिस काइंड ऑफ अ गाला इवेंट हु इज दैट इज माई टीचर हु इज माई ट्रू मेंटर आई थिंक उसकी तस्वीर मेरे पर्स में होनी चाहिए मेरे घर में होनी चाहिए मेरे गुरुद्वारे में होनी चाहिए मेरे घर के मंदिर में होनी Because they shown me the path. Kaake lagu paaye, balihari guru apne jo Govind diyo dikhaye, jo Govind diyo milaye. So this is what the education says, and this is what I just want to conclude. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to be spoken before all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. You have spoken about today's teachers' problem. I really convey my gratitude on behalf of teachers' fraternity. Really, people are facing a lot of problem. During pandemic and post pandemic also you have nicely pointed out the real problem faced by today's teacher. Thank you so much on behalf of all the teachers.
Thank you.
Next I call upon another great personality, Dr. Onat Pandit, Professor IP Innovation and Entrepreneurship at JNU, formerly Dean ABVS ME JNU, Program Director AIM NITI Aayog, Government of India, member IPRPP. Sir, I request you to share your experience on your specialization. Open to you, sir.
Thank you, Nagarajan ji. It is indeed really a privilege that I have been given the opportunity to share my thoughts on the education in this August gathering. We are really blessed with the time frame where we are discussing, brainstorming on the policy which is going to last for next few decades. And I think that's the time frame where we are going to set the ball which is going to roll and which is going to build the country and the generations. And on this important topic, I am really pleased to listen Jagdish Gandhi ji and Manpreet ji. We met in AICT earlier. I think NEP 2020 with Manpreet ji has mentioned, this is going to fulfill the domestic need. Whatever the education system which has been imparted throughout this time frame, hardly that was serving to the society. How many rural or grassroots challenges which are being addressed? Manpreet ji was involved into this Smart India hackathons. The major objective was to throw the problem statement to the students and let student utilize their knowledge. So in my view, the education system should have a practice theory practice approach. First practice is for them to learn the grassroots challenges where the shoe is pinching. Students should know. I think that should be the approach where they will see the entire surrounding. Their imagination, their thought process will get open up. And then they will start analyzing the things which is surrounding to them. Second is the theory. Let them learn, gain the knowledge. Let them be exposed with the actual theoretical concepts, practice, and then second practice is to address this challenges utilizing your own knowledge, technology learning, and the classroom teaching which you have, or practical teaching which you have acquired from the academic institution. And that should be really the transforming. On the other hand, we also need to emphasize on moral values and character building, patriotism. For any country, the humanitarian value should be at a peak. And that is the need of an hour. The way the global peace is being challenged, I think we need the future citizens who are working on those fundamentals. And that can be built through the education system. And that education system is the need of an hour. We all know that 21st century is the knowledge century. The technology adoption, the way it is rapidly happening, and the students and kids are adopting the way technology is being utilized by them. I think we need the proper amalgamation of digital intervention in the education, simply by giving the classes on the virtual platform won't serve the purpose. We will be in need of a change in the curriculum, change in the examination and evaluation pattern. We will be in need of a continuous evaluation. What exactly, which fundamentals are strong for a particular student, and where he is facing the difficulty, and the technology and AI intervention in education system can make it possible. The school principal sitting in his office can know that which student in which class is facing which difficulty in which subject. That much specification is possible in nowadays. And such kind of a digital intervention is required in education. And secondly, it's again a challenge where exactly the internet penetration has reached. Government has ensured that internet FTTH is reaching to each and every village in India. But how this should be utilized? What should be the mode of application of the internet penetration in education? I think that's the challenge, and that should be addressed. And in the forum like World Education Summit, this should be the point of agenda for all of us. The fourth aspect which I want to emphasize is the education should address the local need. An initial phase of the schooling should always have influence of the local culture, local system, local festivals, local language, our cultural values. The student should have a pride for their history. The history is not just the 150 years of a history which is being captured into the textbook. That's the shift which is required, that we need to teach them the history of a chemical sciences, history of a physics, history of a maths, history of the economics, history of the trades, history of the calculation and accounting. All these are really very much in need. How can a generation forget this? And how can we afford to skip this kind of a important element from the education? That's again an important point. And I think national education policy is giving us the opportunity to rejuvenate the entire education system in a holistic manner. We all have seen the importance of a data management and cybersecurity, the kind of a tech-savvy generation which is utilizing the technology in toto, and they need to get the exposure about their data and the data security and cybersecurity. Are we prepared to offer them this kind of exposure? They can practice the technology, but they are not aware about their own data. They are not aware about the cybersecurity, the way data is being utilized. I think government has utilized and offered this opportunity, but this is not getting translated into the education system. From 2014 onwards, in pre-2014, there was a data for each and every citizen, which was captured in the form of Aadhaar, their facial expression, their fingerprints, their identity, their date of birth, their residential proof, their gender data. Everything was there into the system. But this government has effectively utilized in translating those data into the offering the benefits through this government programs. They were knowing, government was knowing that by linking this Aadhaar with the PAN card, they would able to know that how many people can afford to surrender the subsidies in the LPG connections and how many beneficiaries are in need of a subsidized actually at a zero cost. And that was the beautiful interpretation of a data and execution of a program. Few crore people have surrendered their subsidies and few crores have got the cylinder at their home without any cost. So excellent data utilization in government and governance. Are we prepared that next generation is going to use this kind of platforms? This is not just a government responsibility. We are 135 crore of a population in India. We are generating billions of GB data. How much of an infrastructure is equipped for this? How many such a hardware, software engineers which we have to manage this data? We need the futuristic education where our domestic need is going to get fulfilled. It's a high time to rejuvenate the entire education system, knowledge systems, and equally bring the local and domestic need. Education should fulfill the domestic need for the citizen. And that kind of education system, which we should be thinking. We are, NEP 2020 is not just a document. We are building the entire 30, 40, 50 years of education system. Though the next policy is likely to come after 25, 30 years, but this will have the impact of the work which is going to be done now. Implementation, people feel that implementation is not yet taking a pace, but I can see that implementation is already happening. In JNU, we are in multidisciplinary education, our engineering students are also getting the economics course, getting the innovation course, getting the entrepreneurship course. They have a dual degree in engineering as well as the management or economics. In JNU, we have the amalgamation of a Sanskrit, biology, and Ayurveda. How can Ayurveda be taught without the knowledge of a biology and Sanskrit? Or Sanskrit without having the exposure of a Charak Samhita or Rigveda, and our all Veds, which has equally the important elements which is being taught. All the entire this amalgamation is required, and this has already been started in JNU and many other universities also. So time to rejuvenate entire education system. We have been given the opportunity to set this system, and World Education Summit is also offering us the opportunity to reset this sustainable development goal. Our technology and innovation should be focused on addressing all these SDGs. How can we address the SDG problem without the technology and innovation into this? I think this is the time for setting this ball rolling in the direction where the societal needs are fulfilled. I am thankful to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to sharing my views. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor, for your wonderful speech. Next, I call upon Sri Tulsi Diwari, a member, Board of Governors, IIT, Bhilai, entrepreneur, mindset coach, strategist, an economy and author, founder and CEO, Ultratech Laboratories Private Limited. Sir, I request to share your opinion on this today's agenda.
First of all, thank you very much, Mr. Nagarajan, and I appreciate the organizers to bring us all together here on this wonderful platform. And to begin with, I'd like to thank Dr. Manpreet, Dr. Manpreet, to bring the point of speaking from honesty. And all that he said, if I can sum up in one word, amounts to intellectual corruption. And we should be willing to look at self-critically at all levels. The point is, how big is this challenge about the education, actually? I want to share one very short story. It's a question, actually. And I request each one of you to ask this question in your own mind about the people you know from your own life. And you may ask others also, what do they think? You'll get a feel. The question is like this. And generally, I ask these questions from parents who come across me. There are three kinds of children, I ask them. First is a child who is trying to bully other friends, other people. There is a child, second time, who is always getting bullied by others. And the third one, he or she is neither bullying anybody or not gets bullied by anybody. So if you take all the people you know from your life, just in a quick calculation in your mind, at what percentage of people you know from your personal experience of your own life journey fall in category 1, category 2, and category 3? Generally, my understanding has been that people hesitate and finally they come up with something less than 5% in the third box, where neither the people will get bullied nor they bully anybody. And then I ask the second question. How many of you parents would like your child to be in the third box, where they are neither getting bullied by anybody or not bullying? The answer is always 100. So our journey is very, very far when we talk about the reality of something going wrong. Having said that, we live in a world of confusion. It is dominating world across. It's not only about India. It is across the whole world. And that is why $1 trillion debt on students in America is ticking like a bomb on the heads of American parents and their children, who are paying so much money for education that they do not know, because they don't get equivalent jobs. So much for the higher education. And I am also a student of American education system. I studied in 79. I did my master's in chemical engineering from Chicago. So from those days of $5,000 a year, now it costing $100,000 a year. So that trauma and the confusion and the 30% Americans are actually poor. So what is right and what is wrong? Nobody seems to be understanding. And we in India are wanting to follow the American model. And they themselves are confused what is going on. Look at Britain, they are confused whether they should be part of Europe or they should be out of it. And finally, 50-50 vote in a borderline. And 50-50 voting is actually an indication of confusion, not about the clarity, because one has to take vote on some side. So maybe a 51-49 decided that they should be out, and still they are wondering. I'm just pointing to that the whole world is really confused today. It's absolutely confused about everything, that what is the purpose of life? What is the importance of money? I mean, so importance of education. Now, obviously the importance of education, why so? I mean, I'll give you a simple thing, like any product which is selling in the market, whether it is a laptop or whether it is a sari that our women buy, you know, every product has been made in over a period of say 1 day or 2 day or 5 days, you know, if you take the production cycle. Now, does anybody buy a product where red color is in a sari is splashed over the blue color, or blue color is splashed over the red color? You are so particular about the product quality when you're buying in the marketplace. And these products are manufactured in a matter of days. And here is a human mind, which is also a product, mind you. It is a product. It starts with a blank canvas as a child, and it takes 20 years to make this product. It is not a joke. This is the only product in the world which takes almost 20 years before a person can be called that he or she can be independent, and they cannot get into the real life without that. And what is the kind of attention we give in terms of your making a sari? You are aware what material is required. You calculate all back. You design everything. You make sure that this line is there. It is not shifting here or there. And in case of children, what are the parameters we are setting that this is what I want to see in my child, and whether it is deviating? Am I measuring? Am I aware what raw materials are required to make what kind of a child 20 years from now? So there is a huge gap, you know, in our approach. So now when we talk about 21st century, what is the major thing? The most important aspect of 21st century is that it has brought internet revolution. And that internet revolution is a cause of major, major disruption all across in every aspect of life. Now this disruption is also naturally going to be driving education. It is common sense. So this is where the opportunity lies. So when we have a big challenge, when I mentioned that maybe we have to go from 5% of what we are having to 100%, that journey, so the silver lining is this internet revolution, that here is the opportunity which can address that challenge. Now, I want to simply sum up by saying that what Dr. Unnatji brought in, that we need strategic focus about next few decades. It's not 1 or 2 years or something. So strategic course corrections are required, in my view, in 3 points. And these 3 points are, number one is about purpose of education. Let us be crystal clear, actually, what is the purpose of education? We cannot be saying hundreds of things. You know, hundreds of things can be subset of one thing. When you define that there is an Everest on Himalaya, you don't talk about 100 peaks, you talk about Everest, and then everything else falls in the in place, you know, as to how a person has to reach Everest. So what is that one thing? In my view, the purpose of education, that Everest is one thing, is create a self-learning mindset. Creating a self-learning mindset. How many children we can claim are self-learners? How many teachers? How many time you have to request students to learn, to appear, or how many teachers themselves are self-learners? This is the question. And there are two qualities in my mind which are required to make a person self-learner. number one quality, a person has to be clear about purpose of living. Why am I born? Why am I living? What is it going to happen after I die? So the answer to the question is, it is not money. Money is only a means towards everything. There is something greater in me. And that greater is what? Like there is a seed in my mind. Somewhere the Almighty has put a seed in my mind. I need to understand whether I am an apple, I am an orange, I am a banana, or what is that seed of me? I need to know as early in life as possible. And then that is what I need to become. So that clarity of living a purpose, that I want to blossom to the fullest of my seed. So that when I am matured, my seed is got converted into hundreds of other seeds in the form of fruit. Whether it is an actor or a sports person, whatever it is, a scientist or a businessman or a politician, but how many people can claim they know that what is their real seed inside? You know, talking about skills and intelligence and all this is where the confusion lies, you know. These are means, they are not the goals. A skill is a means, not a goal. And efficiency of intellect is a means, it is not a goal. You know, so irrespective of what is the intelligence level of a person, every person can climb to the Everest of his own peak. One will be slower, one will be faster. It is not important. Whether one reaches the Everest is important, and that is possible in my view. You know, so the second quality which is required to be a self-learner, I mentioned, is the self-confidence. And I'll give you another story here very briefly, very quickly. You know, my father never had an opportunity to go to formal education. But luckily, in his village of Khudiala, it's a very small village in Rajasthan near Jodhpur. When he was 7 years old, they had a guru in the Gram Guru. And he went through 2 years of education. You know, he told me that. So he goes into that 4 o'clock, they get up until 7 o'clock, until at night time, he's with them. And with the teacher, and lunchtime only the children go to home. Now, at the end of 2 years of education, the guru tells him, my father, and that's what I'm talking about 100 years ago, 1934, you know, and he tells him, Ja beta, let me speak in English only, go my son, and that is to a 9-year-old, a guru is telling, go my son, in any part of the world, and you can stand on your own feet. Now, this is the self-confidence. This is the self-confidence without which any formal education is meaningless. So my point is that the self-confidence has to become the second point in being a self-learner. Now, strategically, I mentioned purpose of education is this. Second point I want to mention, what is the role of society? Now, this is again a strategic correction required in our mindset in society as a whole. And this has been beautifully talked about by Dr. Manpreet. And that is about that respect for teacher to be the highest in society. You know, it should be so high that everybody wants to be a teacher someday. And mind you, there can be a time in next 25 to 50 years, hopefully, and hopefully I see that such things is, how is it? I'm just sharing one idea with you. How is it? Just imagine a society where everybody is looking forward to become a teacher in a primary or middle school. The requirement is so tough. Requirement of becoming teacher in a primary and middle school of a future society becomes so tough that a person makes sure that he remains in such a great shape in terms of his thinking, his work, his ethics, that he's waiting with, by the time he's 50 years old, that somebody, some school, primary or middle school, will invite him as a teacher. And when in gatherings, he's introduced to people, all people say that he is a teacher of a primary school. And that is the all that is required to be stated about a teacher. That is, I hope it is not seen as a utopian dream, but without that, without making teaching as such an important element no matter how many billions of dollars you have, but if you are a teacher, you are ahead of that. So this is the role of society to bring the importance of teaching, and that is mentoring, into and the third course correction, what is the role of government? So these are the three points. The third, what is the role of government? Role of government is very simple and straightforward, and that is making sure that self-learner, that is the student, and mentors, their job should become easier and easier every day in three ways. Economically, so that things are affordable. Physically, so that it is not in a distant, a bright child in a rural area is not accessible, not able to access a professor in Harvard. Now in digital world, it's possible, you know. So physically and digitally, which is happening now because of the internet revolution. So this three corrections, this three strategic core correction, in my view, is the Everest of the future of the education. If it is done, all other things will fall in place, is my belief actually. And finally, I just like to say one sentence: let respect of mentor earned over life command necessary discretions in decentralized manner, because you can never make a law-driven systems that is perfect. Never ever a law-driven system can ever be perfect. The discretion has to be there with the mentor who has got the respect. And that is how the decentralization of the regulatory methodology is required by the government. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful speech. A small request to all the speakers. As you know that we are running out of time, therefore I request all the speakers to restrict yourself within 5 to 6 minutes so that, you know, we can try to wind up our session as per our schedule. Next, I invite the great personality from Malaysia, Mr. Chipo Yang Hathar. He is the author, entrepreneur, mentor, and life coach, corporate trainer at Rich Mind Consultant, Malaysia. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. First of all, I would like to say thank you to India and also sir, the organizer of a World Education Summit 2021 for inviting me to this prestigious occasion. Now I have a sharing on what is happening in Malaysia, especially in my company, the way I see the situations after the pandemic and before the pandemic. Over years, I have three topics to share. The first one is the pandemic moment show us the following. Number one, we need to prepare ourselves for emergency, unexpected event. Like before pandemic, a lot of parties in institution of higher learning, even in a secondary school, primary school, they are not prepared. Yeah, they are not prepared to study online. Yeah, and they all are stuck, facing a lot of problem. And secondly, we need to have an alternative teaching method in today's education landscape, where we need to have an online and an offline and also hybrid, where we apply both online and physical education teaching method. And the third one, the way I see in today's education system, where a lot of country in the world, especially in the developed country, they are not ready in terms of IT infrastructure and gadget. We can see, especially in the area where students stay in the remote area, where there are lack of internet connections. Basically, they are left out in this education's opportunity during this pandemic moment. And also the next very important focus we need to focus on post-pandemic is we need to train our education provider. Can be the management, can be the teaching staff in the university or in the secondary school, how to teach in various platforms. We notice in Malaysia, there are a lot of teaching staff, they are not well trained to teach online. They do not know how to manage international IT gadget to give effective and efficient teaching to the student. And also, we need to create awareness among the citizens in the country to get ready to welcome new norm in teachings and learning, both adult learning and also secondary school or at tertiary education, where we can see a lot of citizens, a lot of people out there, they still cannot adapt to the changes of this post-pandemic to learn and to study, to mingle, to interact with their teaching staff. And the next one, I see the most problem that faced by the education provider, there are lack of reading material and also references in e-library. I believe there are a lot of universities and also tertiary education provider, they do not have enough reading materials and also references or journal that is in an e-platform for the student, for the researcher, for the master degree student to do research. So they are having a lot of problem to complete their thesis, yeah? And the next one, this is very important, the way I see it, is that a lot of institutions or provider, they are still in the process of designing examinations in e-platform, or we have this competency test via e-platform to test the efficiency and the understandings of the student. The second area where I want to discuss here in this world education platform is we need to shift our paradigm in education delivery system, where learning can be done via conventional and unconventional method. No more conventional, must go to the classroom, must go to the lecture hall. Now we can choose either go to lecture hall or go to the virtual platform. And also nowadays, like today, I'm so fortunate, I'm so thankful to the Indian government. I'm also thankful to the MGI for inviting me through this Zoom platform, where we can accommodate thousands of people at one time to study the same topic or to discuss the same common interest, as compared to last time where we are confined to physical classroom constraint, where only accommodate 20, 30, or 200 people. And also now, we also need to learn how to be fun while teaching through technology assistant, virtual intelligence, and so on. And also we can save costs as well. Like now, I am in Malaysia and all the counterpart is in India now. We can save costs in learning via e-platform, where we can save costs in terms of accommodation, food, transport, and et cetera. And also, this is the very important observation I see from Malaysia, where this e-learning received very good response from millennials, the young people after 2000, the born after 2000, and Gen Z, where they prefer to acquire the knowledge and also the information through third channel. That means they are not preferred to face-to-face. They also want to have information immediately received through email, through WhatsApp, WeChat, Messenger, and etc. What they want is with immediate response to the information they wanted compared to the human contact. And the last sections I want to share over here is the challenges we face in new norms education landscape in the world. The first one is, while we are embracing e-platform in education, we need to make sure the education quality to be maintained. Education quality must be maintained to ensure the learner can learn with the intellect and also the competency from the education. And also, we need to focus on the student to make sure they concentrate in the Zoom study or in the e-platform. So we need to discuss, to study, to do research on how to ensure students in e-platform, they can remain focused for at least 1 hour to 2 hours without any distraction. And the next one, if we want to go into e-platform in developing country where internet is a problem, we need to ensure internet connection is stable, especially in rural area, so that those students, those learners in a rural area also can learn as compared to the city student. And the last one, as we know, e-learning, e-education involve high cost of infrastructure of starting. So we need to think of the way how to reduce the cost of education through e-platform. This involves the Ministry of Education, this involves the local government, and also this involves the local education provider. So in short, over here, my sharing is more on what we need to learn post-pandemic, what we need to shift into our paradigm, and also the challenges we face in the face of this new norm after pandemic. So this is my sharing from Malaysia. Once again, I want to thank the organizer of this World Education Summit 2021 for inviting me to this sharing session. Thank you very much. Namaste.
Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation. We are grateful to you. Next, I call upon Mr. Karanveer Singh. He is a chairman, Vishnam Global Shaper, World Economic Forum, and he is a TEDx speaker, IIM alumnus, and mentor. Sir, I request you to share your thoughts on this particular topic. Mr. Karanveer Singh.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon, good evening, everyone in India. I'm Karanveer Singh from Switzerland, and the time right now here is 3:30. Let me switch on my video, sorry. Yeah, I hope I'm visible. So yes, thank you, Nagarajanji, for this great initiative, and especially to all the dignitaries I have been listening to. Firstly, thanks to Charles Wharton Society for Research and Innovation, wherein you are doing so commendable work, wherein we are focusing on World Education Summit in such a, I would say, innovative manner, wherein now we have these kind of options to interact from the globe for one agenda without being physically present there. That's the power of technology. And special thanks to Dr. Abhishek Pandeyji, Dr. Puneet Dwivedi, and then of course, as we have heard, Abdullahji, Dr. Mannaji, and Mr. Gandhiji, they were so touching and you know, giving so inspirational thought process. I believe I will start with a food for thought for everyone sitting in Geneva. I met a lot of people, traveled more than 30 countries in my life, and spoken on various topics, did a lot of work with different organizations. I feel during last stage of your life, when you are just finishing your life, what thoughts that comes to your mind when you're just finishing up with your life? According to me, I always feel sometimes people say, agar aapki legacy chhoot jaye piche, to you have achieved everything in life. If whatever you have planned for yourself in the, or whatever you have experienced all through your lifetime, if you are shedding aapki jo legacy hai wo piche chhoot jaye, that means you are a legendary person. Aisa hum apne achievement ko sochte hain. I believe, what does legacy means? It's about jo aaj knowledge humne apne pure lifetime mein liya. Jaise jo Mr. Gandhi was speaking, I could see the burning desire in his mind to give everything what he has gained in his life. And that is the whole agenda about everyone when they finishes their life. So, and that's all about exchanging knowledge, transferring technology, transferring knowledge, and educating others. And this is something which goes till our last breath. If you feel whatever I have learned, now people know what I have learned, this is your legacy which will go on. Aapka naam rahe na rahe, aapke thoughts zarur rahenge. And this is where I experience that how we should approach towards more innovative ideas towards education. Jahan hum baat karte hain rote learning ki, rote learning to practical learning, we have to switch. Honestly speaking, I even when I travel around, or even when I walk around my house or somewhere, I see a lot of small kids, I mean, aged 6 years, 7 years of age group. They're just like a human chain holding each other's hands, walking through. Aur wo kahan ja rahe hain? They're going to the museums. Kyun ja rahe hain? Because they want to learn the diversity, learn the history. Matlab, unko class mein bitha ke kitab mein nahi samjhaya ja raha ke museums mein le jaakar unko history batai ja rahi hai. They're showing the real. They're showing the real people behind what they have learned in their lives. Or kaise unko museums mein, agar biodiversity batani hai, to unko kitab utha ke, they don't tell them ke biodiversity mein humare kya hai. They take them to the forest. They take them to the Alps or to the mountains. This is the kind of knowledge we need to bring to the people. Jahan hum kitabon se zyada unko bahar lekar jayein. And on the other side, same as Dr. Manna was saying, we need to focus on teachers as well. We have so many dignitaries, so many good teachers who are sharing the knowledge. We should also have something called PBI, wherein performance-based incentives for the teachers. Because anyway, there are a lot of teachers who put day and night for their children, for their students. And there are some who don't put that much attention, and we don't differentiate. हम अगर सही को सही गलत को गलत नहीं कहेंगे एंड वी पुट ऑल ऑफ देम ऑन द सेम प्लेटफॉर्म इट्स नॉट अ गुड आइडिया सो वी आल्सो नीड टू फोकस ऑन द इंसेंटिवाइजेशन फॉर द टीचर्स एंड ऑफ कोर्स आई सी लॉट ऑफ कोलैबोरेशंस हैपनिंग इन जिनीवा वेयर इन बिग यूनिवर्सिटीज अराउंड द वर्ल्ड आर कमिंग एंड डूइंग बायलेटरल्स मल्टीलेटरल्स विद द डिफरेंट यूनिवर्सिटीज ग्लोबली आई होप इन कंट्री लाइक इंडिया वी हैव अ ह्यूज स्कोप for the collaboration with the foreign universities, wherein we start approaching research centers to exchange in cross-border collaborations. Also, I believe a lot of worldwide exchange programs are happening at every level, at all stages, from primary education to the higher education. There also, there is a huge scope which we can figure out and can start collaborating on this. I'll share a small example of the education scenario which I faced in central part of India, that is Madhya Pradesh, in Indore. What happens, I'll give you more introduction about me. I'm associated with World Economic Forum as a global shaper from the last 6.5 years. And there was a project we were doing for the school kids. I mean, we only opted this project for India, wherein the challenge we were facing was that there are a lot of school children who are dropping out of the schools, and especially the girl children. And we could not understand the reason behind it. And it was a big kind of a challenge for us. We picked the challenge. We did the survey in the remote areas of Indore and in some villages, wherein we focused and we surveyed why the kids are not ready to come to the school or why they have stopped going to the schools. And it was mostly in the girls. And to our surprise, it was not the bad education system, but it was an infrastructural support. Can you imagine? The schools were not having even basic sanitation facilities like toilets and all. And with this kind of scarcity, kids were feeling shy and were not opening up with the teachers or with the surroundings. And they stopped going to the schools after the age of 9 or 10. We spoke to the villagers, and even I'm sure if you know more about Indore, few years back, Indore was not even ODF, open defecation free city. It just became few years back when it became the smart city. So there was a huge problem of scarcity of toilets, and then we spoke through World Economic Forum. We spoke to one of the venture capitalist groups in UAE, that was Abraj Group, who agreed upon our request of building toilets in these kind of schools. We started with one school, and then another, and the focus was just to help them with all the infrastructure support we can give. And fortunately, all this was through a grant program, and fortunately, we could see the dropout rates getting so drastically reduced, and people were so motivated, and believe me, not just children or the students, even the teachers were not motivated to come to the school on daily basis just because of this. I mean, whenever they see their monthly periodic tenure, they generally used to take leaves. But with this kind of infrastructure support, we could see the change. And the best part in the whole project was, it was a project for 15 years, wherein not just school students or the teachers who were maintaining the sanitation facilities, even the villagers in the surroundings were using those facilities and maintaining that in a sustainable manner. So we can see not just the education system, even the infrastructure support is very much required to keep the kids motivated. And same we see in the post-pandemic era, where we are seeing that people don't have even small basic mobile phones or the tablets to join the calls on virtual technology. So this is also where we need to see the kind of inferiority which kids are keeping in mind, that silently they are just going away from the education. This is also the kind of concern which we need to focus on. So I hope with my expertise or sitting here, what all collaborations, what all expansions we can do, I'd be more than happy to work for this organization to support in any way possible, and always there for so humble dignitaries present here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. We are grateful to you. Next, I call upon Dr. Aditya Maheshwari, Faculty, Operation Management and Quantitative Techniques Area, Indian Institute of Management, Indore. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Nagarajan, and thank you to all the organizers who have provided this opportunity and platform to share my views. The speakers before me have spoken very well. Especially, I would like to mention Dr. Manpreet's speech, which covered almost every point which I had in mind, and he spoke very honestly. So, one thing which I want to share, which is relevant to the topic of this meeting, is that the future of digital education in India and future of education in India. So I would like to share my teaching experience in that. So before the pandemic, there were lots of talks going on about the changing pedagogy of that there will be flipped classroom, digital intervention. And then the corona pandemic struck and we are forced to go into those platforms and we are forced to go into those pedagogies. So from teaching community, I can say we were pretty hesitant initially to adopt to those methodologies. But over the time, we are teachers, so we were student also, we adopted very well. So as a learning after teaching 1.5 years online, where I was only accustomed to teach offline, I could say before that we had two mediums, either to teach. There are two possibilities, either to teach a student in a classroom or not to teach. So accessibility. So now we have a third alternative, that is online. So I would rate that alternative somewhere between not to be taught or to be taught in the classroom. The first what we realized, including my students who were taking up my courses and my experience in teaching, is that there is no replacement, no alternative of a one-to-one classroom teaching, face-to-face classroom teaching. There are various issues. People can discuss issues about it. They know it. Those who teach it and those who learn from online platform, they also know it, that the attention spans are lower. In online, the peer learning is not there, et cetera, et cetera. So one thing which is clear to me and in my mind is there is no alternative to offline teaching. This is the best mode of teaching. So what is an alternative? What is the second best thing? The second best thing we have discovered during this pandemic, all of us know that instead, if somebody is not coming to classroom, there is a middle path called digital intervention. And there we should focus on, and we should be honest to ourselves that this is not an alternative to classroom. It is a bridge. It is a bridge to those who do not have technology, who do not have access to high quality classrooms, high quality content. But this is a bridge to learn, they may not be able to reach to that level of knowledge where teacher and student are interacting face to face. But nevertheless, this is a very good alternative that have come up. And third thing is not teaching anyway. So that is the worst part. And this technology intervention helped us in navigating in this extremely difficult times. And more or less with me, especially our institute did not had any
lost batches, though we were there were delays in starting the batches, but due to the Zoom platform and the other online platforms, including the online examination platform, we have not lagged it. Yes, but I can say that we, if the class compared to the classroom teaching, yes, we lagged in some of the learning experience, and students know how the exams were held and how the results were out for the 10th and then plus two. So about all these pros and cons, we should be, there is an alternative medium, and I think it is the future in which we can provide an high quality intervention to students who do not have any access. Second thing is that an online platform can be a sort of a alternative if the classroom size is very small. My guess is if there are between 10 to 15 students, and a teacher can focus on each and every student with their taking their video on and interacting with them personally, then it can mask some of the disadvantages which are present in non-offline mode. So this is one insight which I want to share, my personal insights. And only last one point I want to like to make in a general point is that the previous speakers spoke about various aspects of education. I would just like to add one point on that aspect of education, that we should focus on truthfulness, satya. That is the most important thing, and everything else will follow if we practice what we preach and be truthful to ourselves, and we always say truth and truth always, and it should not compensate, or it should not mask itself in a sort of a greater good or a short-term good of the society. Okay. And the previous speakers have spoken that United Nations have failed and all other things have done, but we have not gone into the reasons why they have failed. One of the reason I can see that in our speeches, and we using very flowery words, we try to mask the truth and try to present ourselves in a peace-loving or in a well-maintained individual. But several times peace is good, but it masks the truth. Therefore, I think in the long run, these organizations fail to achieve their objective, though they have a very noble cause and the very noble goal they have started. So with this, my limited submission, I would like to conclude my speech. Thank you, organizers, and thank you, Nagarajan, for providing me the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Aditya. I 100% agree with you. So in future, we have to go with 50% offline and 50% online. So it will be like a blended kind of thing. So there is no other go. We have to migrate from conventional method to digital platform. I invite Professor B.N. Sinha, alumnus IIT, senior professor, Birla Institute of Technology, Meshra. Professor B.N. Sinha, over to you. Dr. Sinha? Okay, next I call upon Dr. Prashant, Associate Professor, Ramanujam Fellow, Center for PLO, Biosciences and Biomedical Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Indore, Madhya Pradesh. Dr. Prashant, over to you.
Thank you very much to the organizers. Thank you, Dr. Nagaraja. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Perfectly audible.
So, the previous speakers have touched upon all the important aspects related to what I was trying to articulate in my session or my part of the speech. And therefore, I would emphasize and pick those points which I thought are pertinent and very relevant. I know Dr. Aditya Maheshwari has talked about online education. There are lots of advantages of it. There are limitations. And the COVID-19 pandemic emphasized that, yes, indeed, in-person teaching has no substitute, and role of a teacher is very, very important in the development, in the process of learning and teaching. apart from these superficial issues, I just want to talk about some fundamental issues. I want to ask question, are we doing right investment in the foundation of students making? Are we investing a lot of resources, efforts, money for the primary education? Is our curriculum giving justice to the children who are future of this small village, the whole earth? So I think most important thing for us that what Dr. Aditya told, that truth-based society, and that can only happen, I'll just pick from there, that our curriculum should be blended in such a way that we take care of morals, values, and ethics in our curriculum. There should be a way to inculcate these values in our students until and unless we have that. The honest society, honest community can only make sure that there is a progress and there is a peace. Many a time, we think that these are the things which are taken care by a family, but families are now outsourcing all these issues to the school. The teachers or the education system and the schools and colleges have considered that as a business platform. Just they are considered that they should work on making profit. And if your objective is to make profit, you will not make sure that holistic education is given to students. Your objective is making profit, and you will not make sure that students are learning morals and ethics, and they're being honest or not. Because education institutions themselves are not honest. Same time, teachers, they are very aggressive for their rights, but are we equally responsible for our responsibilities? That's the hard question we need to ask. If we teachers, we fulfill our role and we inculcate the role's values and we become a role model. Previous speaker told that our teachers' role model, are they ideals and idols? Who is responsible for that? Are teachers responsible for that or not? Is behavior of a teacher is ideal so that students should feel that, yes, this is the life I want to follow? We should ask that question. At the same time, we should also ask, what is the society asking for? What is the responsibility of a society? Is society asking for value-based education? Where is the pressure coming from society where they are demanding and dictating the school that this is what I want in the curriculum? So I feel that everyone of the society, whether it is parents, family, education institutes, and most important role of teachers, as well as the policymakers and government, they should make sure that we create and inculcate scientific temper in our society. Until and unless we have scientific temper in our society, we will not expect that we will have innovators of future. If that mindset is not there in the students, they will be just copy-pasting things. So fundamental reforms and interventions are required from the memory-based education system to thinker-based education system. I myself, as a teacher at IIT, face a lot of problems regarding the originality of the thoughts and originality of the language. Because until they graduate, they are taught how good they are in copying. And they are evaluated based on a person who is good in copying. If we don't discourage that and encourage them, whatever way they articulate their own thoughts, in their own language, in their own words, that originality will not come. So a lot of interventions are required at different levels, in schools, in colleges, and in society as a large. And that foundation, the single basic unit of a society, the family, they need to ask these questions. Am I going to just make a money and that asset, that property is going to be there with me, or my responsibility is also there with my kids? And therefore, I may be earning little less for those well-to-do families and invest quality time with the kids so that they get value-based moral education, so that future of this world is bright. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. A small announcement to all the panelists over here. If I miss out anybody's name, just text your name in the chat box. Meantime, I'd like to share the pamphlet of yesterday and today's event and the posters of various speakers and the invitation we have communicated to Ministry of Education, Government of India, and the response we have received from Ministry of Education, from Secretary, from Ministry of Education for your kind information. So meantime, you can post your text your name in the chat box. So we are thankful to Modern Group of Institution. They are our academic partner. And the day one yesterday, we had a detailed deliberation on grassroots approach. And today we are discussing about a journey towards a new world. We had wonderful 21 speakers yesterday, and today also we have 21 speakers. So we have invited 42 speakers for this particular World Education Summit. We are thankful to all the speakers, chief guest and guest of honors. And these are our organizers, sponsors. And we are very much thankful to Government of India, Ministry of MSME for giving constant support, Ministry of Education, Government of India for their encouragement, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, Government of India, and Department of Science and Technology. Actually, we are expecting Education Minister in today's session, but suddenly got a call from PMO office, so he could not able to join today, but he'll be joining on some other occasion. So this is for your information. We are thankful to our chief guest, guest of honor, and various speakers from different parts of country. And these are the communication with the Secretary of Minister Secretary. So on behalf of CWSAR, I convey my sincere gratitude to all the partners, supporting partners, academic partners, and the government agencies for their constant support and encouragement for making this two days grand summit possible. If I miss out anybody's name, so I request all the panelists to switch on your video to capture the virtual group photo. I request all the panelists to switch on your video. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So it is time to conclude the 2 days, the grand virtual summit on education. I would like to start my concluding remarks with the same message. Yesterday I have conveyed my sincere gratitude to all the guests, chief guest and guest of honor and speakers. So without you, this particular session and this particular event would not be possible. So the very grateful to all the speakers from different parts of country. And I hope you all have enjoyed yourself today and learned something. What an exciting day. We have 42 talented speakers from different countries from yesterday and today. After listening to many of your views and seeing examples of your work, you have reminded me that talented people simply are not as tied down by conventional thinking as the rest of us, because you see problems differently. You tend to arrive at different solutions. That is such an incredible but undervalued resource. Thank you all again for being here, and I encourage you all to stay connected with each other on the road ahead. We'll meet again on some other grand occasion with a different agenda and with a different panelist. Until then, take care. Good night.